Hi, I'm Mike Elam, and this is Buford Pusser, The Other Story.
Hello and welcome back to another episode of Buford Pusser, The Other Story. This is episode 19, where we're going to discuss the white iris and the pecan farm, along with the Razzle Game. Cover a lot of this in my book, Buford Pusser, The Other Story. It's available on Amazon. And today we're going to be talking about some of Toehead's FBI files that concern all this. With me is Dennis Hathcock. Dennis, how are you?
Fine. How are you doing, Mike?
I'm doing well, except for some video problems here. Dennis, what can you tell me about the white iris?
At what point? What time?
Let's say like when a tourist was traveling down Highway 45 and they came upon it for the first time, what would they see?
When I first opened it,
yeah,
you'd come down through there and you'd see baskets of fruit turned up, you know, like you do in Florida. You'd see a big signs that said pecans for whatever they were, a dollar for 5 pounds or whatever. Free whatever, you know, like free samples of. Like the cherry and apple cider that they had. They had cherry and apple, and you could get a little bitty cup of it. And, you know, that's about, I mean, of course, they you could buy beer in there then, but the main thing is it was just like a tour. It was very similar to like if you walked in a small Stuckey's.
Okay. It didn't strike you as a place where you'd go to gamble then?
Not hardly. No, but, you know, the Razzle Game they did up there, when you went to check out, everything was just seemed just as legitimate as it could be. And when you went to check out, they would just ask, would you like to play have a free game on the, they had some name for it. And of course, most people would say, well, I don't know what, and they'd tell, oh, here, you could win this and you can win that. And of course, most people said, oh, if it's free, yeah. Once they did that, they just built them up from there. Oh, you've got so many points here. You want to try again? And, you know, they found, built them up and outcounted them. Yeah.
So it didn't strike you as a place to gamble. I will say that on my Facebook page, Buford Pusser, The Other Story, I have posted a few pages from Toehead's FBI file, which explains exactly how the Razzle Game worked. You know, there was dice, you know, they used a cup to stir the dice in, throw them out on to a hard surface. And then they had a board where they would count up points. But if you want to see how it works, you can go over to my Facebook page and read exactly how the FBI described it as working. You saw some of those devices, I take it.
Oh, yeah. As a matter of fact, one of the guys that actually did that, ran the Razzle game. Of course, I was a kid, you know, and he was going to show me how it worked. And what I can remember is, I think it's four or five dice that you put in a cup and they do it like that, you know, and then roll it out. And the dice he had showed me, they had shaved or took sandpaper and the corners of the dice, certain corners were sanded down. And in that cup, I never will forget, he told me, he said, this is a whip cup. And I remember him showing me inside the cup, it had like indentions running down through the cup where the edges of those dice, I guess, would hit in those and they'd spin them. He was trying to explain, and I was just a kid. I didn't really understand exactly. But like I've told everybody, they had to be pretty talented because he could pretty well make it, like I said, he'd hold it and spin it like that and then throw it out, and he could pretty well make it come up with whatever numbers he wanted to.
Yeah. You know, and kind of as a safety precaution, I understand that they would be the ones to count the numbers. And usually he'd conceal his hand kind of over the dice as he picked them up to check them. So when he added the total up, it came to what he wanted it to be. Then they would compare that number with what was up on a board. Right. And, you know, you'd come close to winning, but not quite there. So they would encourage you.
You wouldn't be but 1 or 2 points off.
And
it's like 1 point winning. Yeah.
And I also understand that a lot of times that as the person was playing the game, part of the scam was they would have somebody walk up that acted like that they had already played and just encourage the guy saying, oh man, you don't know how close to winning you really are. I won this amount of money or this prize just a few minutes ago, and you need to keep on going. When they wanted to quit, that's when this guy would kick in and encourage them to keep playing. And of course, before long, they had lost all their money. And they'd also tell them, as I understand it, that, you know, the operator of the game would tell them, the only way that you can lose is if you quit. And with this other individual standing there, it just made it seem all that more realistic that the game was a real thing. But anyway, I do know that the Shamrock operated this on the Mississippi side of the line. Of course, Buford didn't have any jurisdiction over in Mississippi, so wasn't anything he could do about that. But he did have over the White Irish, but yet he never tried to really intercede on what was going on there.
No.
And tourists would occasionally go up to the sheriff's office and report that, oh, they had lost a lot of money, so on and so forth, which they had. And that a lot of times they had what they call a tail man that would follow this person up to the sheriff's office and intercept them before that they could actually get to the office and say, look, I'm a friend of the owner. And, you know, what went on there back there wasn't right. And I'm going to talk to him about it. But, you know, I've got, let's say they lost $400. He would say, I've got $200 here. You know, I'll give that to you and I'll make sure that the guy that was doing all this gets fired, whatever. And if that wasn't enough, a lot of times they would convince them that, well, if you go in there and report this, you know, yeah, they can go down there and get them for gambling, but they're going to have to arrest you too because you were gambling.
That's right.
So the person would usually take half the money that they lost that was offered up to them, and not bothered to go in because they didn't want to, they were out of state. They didn't want to risk being arrested. And so it just continued. And even if they did go in, Buford would have to tell them the same thing. Well, you were playing the game, you were gambling. So yeah, I can go down there and arrest them, but I'd have to arrest you as well. And so then they wouldn't make their complaint formal. It was all a big deal. And the point is, I guess, that there is all kinds of evidence in the FBI files that Buford knew it was going on and didn't do anything to stop it.
Of course. Of course. Mm-hmm.
And better yet, you've heard of the Pecan Farm.
Yes.
Now, that was set up in Bethel Springs right there under Buford's nose.
And right.
That was operated like a little fruit market, if you will, like a roadside stand, like you'd see a lot of farmers do out in the right. areas. And, you know, you'd go in, buy a 5-pound bag of pecans for a dollar, and then they would talk you into rolling a game of dice. Same thing would happen. And, right. You know, that happened right there in Bethel Springs, right next to Selmer.
Right.
And that
and was, sure enough, and I can it sure enough was right on the highway. I'm about, you know, the, up there at the White Iris, you know, there was other things to detract the people driving down there, but where it was nothing. I mean, they couldn't keep from it. Was like Buford couldn't have come by it without seeing it. I'll put it that way.
And, you know, I'm sure he had to know what was going on there as well.
Of course.
I guess my point is, it was just seems kind of strange that Buford could never arrest anybody for anything that went on at the state line or even there in Bethel Springs. Just a little bizarre. I mean, the FBI knew about it. TBI was aware of it. Buford had to be aware of it, but nothing. The other thing I found interesting about this story is how that they would identify their victims, potential victims, I guess I should say. They'd have somebody, let's say at the Shamrock, when it was operated down there, they'd have somebody out in the parking lot that would look at car license plates to make sure that they were from out of state. And if they spotted somebody from out of state, they'd follow them into the restaurant. And as soon as they walked in, this person who was following them would just say, "Hey, George is back," something like that. And that was the alert that the couple had just walked in, they're from out of state. And yep. Sure enough, whenever they got ready to pay their bill, that's when, you know, there'd be a little bit of small conversation there at the register. And next thing you know, they were invited to play this game and win their breakfast. And then it just went on from there.
That's right.
It's just amazing that you can see all this and understand how it works and that Buford knew it was going on and he didn't do anything. And that's the point I'd really like to get across, is that there was so much of things like this that could have been prevented, could have saved tourists a lot of money, could have saved the reputation for the county, a lot of black eyes, but yet it went on. He never shut down these places.
No. I imagine he made quite a bit of money off of it himself.
Very well may have. It seems like I've never had anybody really tell me that he got a cut of the Razzle Game. But it wouldn't surprise me if he did, because he got a cut of everything else, it seems like. So at any rate, I would encourage everyone to go over to the Facebook page again. As I said, I have these pages from Toehead's FBI file. I've got them posted on there. I'm going to be posting more later today. And that'll give you a good read. That way you're not taking my word for that. You're not taking Dennis Hathcock's word that this is what happened. You're going to see what the FBI had to say. So I don't know. Dennis, this has been kind of short and sweet, but the pecan farm was something that I don't think I'd ever really mentioned before to any great degree. And I just wanted to make sure that people were aware of that.
Well, it didn't last long. When I say that, I'm talking about it was maybe a year. They had it open maybe a year, if that, I'm not sure. But the other thing that's funny about it was Carl, Buford's dad, had to drive back going to where he lived and then come back going to the jail where he was jailer. So, you know.
Yeah, the guy's name that is most often connected to this other than Toeheads was a guy named Roy Allen. And
right.
He's the one that told you about how the game worked. Is that correct?
Right.
Anyway, a lot of money changed hands. And like you say, it only lasted a short time, maybe a year. But something I might point out is that, you know, Toehead went to prison for the three-state moonshine operation just almost a year after Buford was elected sheriff. Not that he had anything to do with Toehead going to prison, but that may have well have been the reason it got shut down, was just the fact that Toehead wasn't there to run things.
Well, you know, I don't know if I've ever said this before, but the white whiskey, they make such a big deal out of white whiskey. Buford Pusser is the only one that was really interested himself in white whiskey. Every deputy he had, except one that had been involved in the white whiskey business, I guess because that's who went around and collected the money, or, you know, but I personally knew three or four people that ran whiskey steals for Buford. He's the one that put the money up, put them in, told him he'd protect them and all that. So, I mean, he's the only one that, well, like I've always told you about the state line, they had enough sense to know not to mess with white whiskey because that was a federal offense.
Yeah.
Right.
And Dennis, we are about to run out of time here, so I'm going to have to shut you down.
Okay.
We'll get back to this in another episode. But again.
Oh, by the way. This I'm drinking in white whiskey. It's one of these ice diet drinks here. So,
well, that's okay. Anyway. I drink a choice of Diet Coke. So,
right.
at any rate, we'll get back to another episode. But I just want to make sure we backed up a little bit and covered this about the pecan farm because we hadn't done it. We hadn't really talked a great degree about the Razzle game and about how that it was actually operated. So, again, like I said, my book is on Amazon, Buford Pusser, The Other Story. I'd remind everybody, go over and read those FBI files on my Facebook page, Buford Pusser, The Other Story. That will really be enlightening to a lot of people. Dennis, I appreciate you being here.
You're quite welcome.
And we'll have you back again at some time in the future, I'm sure.
Okay, that'll be fine.
All right. Have a good day.
All right, you have a good day.